Wednesday. I'm waiting for Wednesday. I'm waiting for Wednesday. I pray you put me on the spot. I do believe you that you love me, that you leave.
Welcome back to Wednesday Wars. This is Mr. Pete. And we're going to dive back into February. We need to finish the chapter. We left off with Holling getting ready to go on a date. Sounds like his first date with Marilee Kowalski on Valentine's Day. And not only that, but he just started reading Romeo and Juliet with Mrs. Baker. And he's going out on a date with $3.78. And his go-to is a Rose and Woolworths. Danny Hupfer is going to the Millridge Inn with My Tea, which is a surprise. Let's find out what happens on Valentine's Day. And we'll finish up February today and head into the Ides of March. All right, here we go. On Valentine's Day, Mr. Gureshi announced over the PA that Mrs. Biggio had baked Valentine's Day cupcakes for the junior high. And each class should send down a representative to pick up the class's allotted number of cupcakes at 1 o'clock. I know this doesn't sound like a big deal, but let me tell you, Mrs. Biggio can bake cupcakes. You never want to turn down a Mrs. Biggio cupcake, even if it is all pastel pink with little hearts in the frosting. All right, so we're going to compare the pastel pink with little hearts in the frosting cupcakes to brown light. Okay, we're not going to head down the cream puff land, but Mrs. Biggio is making pastry again. And, you know, if we were to compare the two, you can see that she's slowly kind of getting to a new place in her life. We thought about the cupcakes all day. We even smelled them baking. Imagery. They're beautiful and lovely, cakey aroma wafting down the halls. When the clock clicked at 1:05, Danny gently reminded Mrs. Baker about the cupcakes. He said that he hoped that she hadn't forgotten them. Mr. Hupfer, has it been your experience that I have ever forgotten anything? Asked Mrs. Baker. Danny had to admit that she never forgot anything. Mrs. Baker looked at her watch. I'm sure that Mrs. Biggio will have made a sufficient number. She went back to reading aloud a tragic love poem by Alfred Lord Tennyson, who, I guess, couldn't figure out how to punctuate his own name. 1:14, still waiting for Mrs. Baker to send down a representative for the cupcakes. Up above the asbestos ceiling tiles, Caliban and Sycorax are stirring, probably since the smell of pink icing is now filling the hallways. Uh-oh. 1:17, still waiting. The bulging asbestos ceiling tiles are vibrating. 1:18, Mrs. Baker finally sends me down to Mrs. Biggio. Danny tells me to hurry, since he is always hungry. 1:18 and a half, I run in the hallways. Mrs. Biggio was waiting for me with the last tray of Valentine's cupcakes. She slid them along the kitchen table toward me, and then slid an envelope across as well. Open it, she said. You'll want it for tonight. I opened it. Inside were 2 tickets for Romeo and Juliet at the Festival Theater. Mrs. Biggio, I said. They're season tickets, and I won't be using them tonight. So, why does she have 2 tickets, and who would she normally be using them for, and why doesn't she need them? So they'll just go to waste if you don't take them. And the gossip I've picked up is that you can use them, unless you want to be known as a cheapskate. Mrs. Baker. Thank you, I said. I can use them. That night, Mr. Kowalski drove Marilee and me to the Festival Theater to see a production of Romeo and Juliet by William Shakespeare for Valentine's Day. We sat in 2 seats in the center of the 3rd row. Marilee held the rose with a ribbon I had bought her. Mr. Goldman played Friar Lawrence.
Well, well. If this could carry all before, I think I see a chance to end the city's strife. If, as I pray, your marriage should prove sweet, you'll turn your family's rancor to pure love. Come, you waverer, and go along with me. I'll grant your wish, and be your wedding priest.
And winked at me once from the stage. The poisoning and stabbing scene was okay, but I still think that Romeo is a jerk. They needed a ghost of Banquo up there to tell them to lay off the stabbing, or maybe Caliban. But Meryl Lee loved it all. She was sobbing by the time it was over. "Wasn't it beautiful?" she said as the lights came up. "So tragic," I said. "That's just the word," she said. Looks like all these lessons with Mrs. Baker's paying off. We walked through the evening light to Woolworth's, where we sat at the lunch counter and I ordered 2 Cokes. Let me tell you, it was just swell. We did the balcony scene together as nearly as we could until the guy behind the counter began to look like he wanted us gone. So we ordered 2 more Cokes to make him happy. I still had $1.37 left, and I didn't want Meryl Lee to think I was a cheapskate. "Are you going to play a part in another Shakespeare play?" Meryl Lee asked. I thought of her sobbing at the end of Romeo and Juliet. "Of course," I said. That wasn't even a Presbyterian lie. It was a flat-out lie. But after doing the balcony scene with Meryl Lee...
"Wait. It is my lady. Oh, it is my love. Oh, that she knew she were. The brightness of her cheek would shame the stars as daylight doth a lamp. Her eyes, set in heaven, would give forth such light that birds would sing and think it were not night. See how she leans her cheek upon her hand. Oh, that I were glove upon that hand, that I might touch that cheek.
Me."
She speaks. Oh, speak again, bright angel.
"Romeo, Romeo. Wherefore art thou, Romeo?"
"Deny thy father and refuse thy name. Or if thou wilt not but be sworn, my love, and I'll no longer be a Capulet."
"Shall I hear more, or shall I speak at this?"
"'Tis but thy name that is my enemy. You'd be yourself if you were not called Montague. What's in a name? That which we call a rose by any other name would smell as sweet. So Romeo would. Romeo, cast off thy name, and for that name which is no part of you, take all of me."
"I take you at your word. Call me your love, and I'll be new baptized henceforth. I never will be Romeo."
I wasn't going to tell her what a jerk Romeo was and how the only way I was going back onto the Festival Theater stage was, well, there wasn't any way. Meryl Lee looked at her watch. "My father will be here soon," she said. "I hope he remembers." I sipped my Coke. I hoped he forgot. All he does is work on the model for the new junior high school. He goes over and over it. He moves a pillar here, then another one there. "It's not classical enough," he says. "It needs to look like the Capitol building. Classical." When Meryl Lee imitated her father, her eyes got large and her hands went up and she spoke low. She should be on the Festival Theater stage. "Classical, classical, classical," said Meryl Lee. There's hardly another word that comes out of his mouth. "My dad doesn't have any pillars," I said. "He's got his model all modern." "Modern?" I nodded. "No pillars, no straight walls, so much glass that they'll need 3 Mr. Vendelaries to keep it all clean. That kind of modern." I asked the guy behind the counter for his pencil. He hesitated a second, since I guess he wasn't so sure about us, but he handed it over and made me promise to give it back, and then I drew the glass domes over the main lobby and gym and the science and the art classrooms and the curved corners and walls and the clusters of classrooms looking out into the sunlit space all over my white paper placemat. "No one's ever come up with that concept for a junior high school before," I said. Meryl Lee stared at my drawing, then went back to sipping her Coke. Her hair is auburn. Did I tell you that? In the lights of Woolworth's? It shimmered. Mr. Kowalski did remember to come. We finished our Cokes, and I handed back the pencil to the guy behind the counter, and Meryl Lee took my placemat as a souvenir. And we walked to the car, hand in hand. Mr. Kowalski dropped me off at my house, and I wasn't sure, sitting in the back seat, how to say goodbye to Meryl Lee, but she saved the day. "'Tis almost morning," she said. "I would have thee gone." "Sleep well upon thine eyes," I said. I didn't have to look at Mr. Kowalski, know that his eyes were rolling in his head. So that was Valentine's Day. Think about the difference between Mr. Kowalski and Mr. Hood Hood. You can see that, you know, Mr. Hood Hood is not the one that drove them around. He apparently doesn't do anything for hauling. But Mr. Kowalski did, even though that their two architecture firms are competing. You can see that Mr. Kowalski is definitely not the same guy that Mr. Hood Hood is. The following week, the school board met to decide on the model for the new junior high school, which was probably why Mr. Kowalski had been spending all his time muttering, classical, classical, classical. The meeting was to be at 4 o'clock in the high school administration building. Mr. Kowalski would present his plan and model, and then my father would present his plan and model, and then the school board would meet in private session to decide whether Kowalski and Associates or Hood Hood and Associates would be the architect for the new junior high school. I know all of this because my father was making me come. It was time I started to learn the business, he said. I needed to see firsthand how competitive bidding worked. I needed to experience architectural presentations. I needed to see architecture as the blood sport that it truly was. Which makes architecture sound like a profession that Macbeth could have done pretty well in. Macbeth did a lot of killing in that play. The meeting was in the public conference room, and when I got there after school, the school board members were all sitting at the head table, studying the folders with the architectural bids. Mr. Kowalski and my father were sitting at two of the high school desks, which made the whole thing seem a little weirder than it needed to be. In front of them was a long table with the two models for the new junior high school, each one covered with a white sheet, like they were some sort of national secret. I sat behind my father. There was a whole lot of preliminary agenda stuff and old business and procedural decisions and all that. My father sat through it coolly, occasionally looking at his watch or squaring the edges of his presentation notes. Mr. Kowalski was more nervous. I'm not sure that his cigarette was out of his mouth for more than 3 seconds at a time. Prediction time. Who's gonna win? Mr. Kowalski, we are ready for your presentation now, said Mr. Bradbrook, who was the chairman of the school board. He sat at the head of the table, sort of like God would sit if God wore a suit. He was smoking too, but he wasn't working at it as hard as Mr. Kowalski was. You have 8 minutes, he said. Mr. Kowalski picked up his presentation notes and angled out of his seat. He went up to the table with the models and stood there for a moment. Then he turned and looked at, no, not my father, at me. Really? My father looked at him, then he turned and looked at me like I should know what was going on, but I didn't. I just shrugged. 7 minutes, said Mr. Bradbrook. Mr. Kowalski cleared his throat. Twice. He looked at his design papers. He cleared his throat again. Then he looked back at me once more and began. Gentlemen, he said, though this is irregular, I've made some significant design changes for the interior of the new junior high since my original submission. In fact, the entire concept has changed markedly. So the plans that you studied for this afternoon's presentation have also changed. I have copies of the new interior plans and ask the board's patience as I show you the concept. This may take slightly longer than the allotted time, but I'm sure the Chamber of Commerce businessman of 1967 won't begrudge Kowalski and Associates a few extra minutes in order to clarify the proposal and to promote the general business atmosphere of the town. This is irregular, said Mr. Bradbrook. Has the new concept affected the cost estimates? Not significantly, said Mr. Kowalski. Mr. Bradbrook considered. Well, he said, if Mr. Hood Hood will agree, then I see nothing wrong with your presentation going slightly longer. Mr. Hood Hood? What could the Chamber of Commerce businessman of 1967 do? He shrugged and nodded, but the back of his neck grew as red as boiling sin, and I knew he did begrudge the extra time. He begrudged it a whole lot. Mr. Kowalski pulled the sheet off from his model of the new junior high school. He cleared his throat again. As you can see, gentlemen, said Mr. Kowalski, the design is quite classical, in the best traditions of our national architecture, for a time when our children desperately need to be reminded of our great American traditions. And it was. It looked like the Capitol in Washington, D.C., with wide steps swooped up past a line of pillars and up to the central doors. Above that rose a steep dome with thin windows cut all around it. On either side of the dome, the building spread graceful wings. all with thin windows again, and behind, the long gymnasium formed the tail, whose rows of bright windows faced south and north to lend in as much light as any gymnasium could ever have. But we live in 1968, gentlemen, Mr. Kowalski said. Just as our children need to be reminded of our great traditions, so too do they need to enjoy the advantages of contemporary technology. I think you'll find the new interior design both modern and innovative. A perfect blend of where we have been and where we are going as a nation. He handed out copies of the plans for the new design to all the school board members, keeping his back to my father and me the whole time. Then he took us all through the new interior. Slowly. No pillars, no straight walls. The roof, a series of glass plates above the science and art rooms. The central dome, three stories high over the main lobby, and clusters of classrooms, all looking out into the sunlit space. All as modern as could be. I don't believe that anyone has ever come up with this blended concept for a junior high school before, said Mr. Kowalski. Then he sat back down. He did not look over at us. Instead, he lit another cigarette and began pulling at it. He shuffled all of his papers into a folder. The school board was astounded. Three of them applauded, not Mr. Bradbrook, since God doesn't applaud. My father turned and looked at me again. His face was very red, and I could tell he was fighting for some kind of control. Falling? There's something you should have told me, isn't there? He whispered slowly. I looked at him. Do you think this is a game? This is the future of Hood Hood and Associates. Everything rides on this. My future and your future. So what did you do? He used the kind of voice that in my family means that a voice a whole lot louder is about to come along in a minute or two. So you'd better start preparing. But let me tell you, I didn't really care all that much about what he would say or how loudly he would say it. I really didn't. Because suddenly, I knew something a whole lot worse. Romeo was a genius compared to me. I hadn't seen at all what Merrilee was doing on Valentine's Day while we were sipping at the lunch counter at Woolworth's. I hadn't realized how easily she had gotten what she wanted from me. My father's design for the new junior high. Do you think that's true? I want you to stop for a moment and ask yourself this question. Is it true? Is that why Merrilee went on a date with Halling to get the plans out of Halling? She did take the placemat with all the plans written on it as a souvenir. Run me on the dashing rocks and hand me a vial of poison. I'm such a jerk. I'd probably drink it. I'm a bigger jerk even than Mickey Mantle. Wow. I got up before I began to bawl like a first grader. Halling, warned my father, a slightly louder, slow whisper. I left the conference room. My red father never did tell me what he did for his presentation. Probably it began with him demanding to see Mr. Kowalski's plans and then suggesting that he took these from Hood Hood and Associates, not saying it outright, but just suggesting it, like he knew it was the truth but wouldn't say it, and then arguing that Mr. Kowalski should withdraw his proposal because it wasn't the same one he had submitted it, and that's not how honest businessmen worked. It would have been something like that, with him getting redder and redder all the time. I bet if you were watching it, you sure would have seen that architecture is a blood sport, and Macbeth couldn't have played it any bloodier than my father. February is a can't-decide-what-it-wants-to-be month on Long Island. What's left of any snow is melted into brown slush and runs in dirty ridges along the street gutters. The grass is dank and dark. Everything is damp, as if the whole island had been dipped under cold water and is only starting to dry out. Mornings are always gray and cold. That's what it was like between Merrilee and me the next day at school. Slushy, damp, dirty, dark, gray, and cold. We didn't look at each other. At lunch, we ate about as far away from each other as we could. And she went outside early, even though Merrilee hardly ever went outside. She didn't come to chorus, so I sang the soprano part for Miss Violet of the Very Spiky Heels alone at our stand. When Mrs. Baker asked if I'd like to partner with Merrilee on the sentence diagramming exercise in the afternoon, I told her I'd rather do it with Doug Zwiedek. On Friday, things were still slushy, damp, dirty, dark, and cold. Merrilee wore sunglasses to school, even though it was gray like always. When Mrs. Baker asked her to remove them for class, she said that her doctor had asked her to keep them on, that she was supposed to keep them on for maybe the rest of the school year. Do you think that's true? I was the only one in class who didn't laugh at that. I looked out the window. For the next Wednesday, I wrote an essay for Mrs. Baker about what Shakespeare wanted to express about being a human being in Romeo and Juliet. Here's the first sentence in my essay. What Shakespeare wanted to express about being a human being in Romeo and Juliet is that you better be careful who you trust. Here's the last sentence. If Romeo had never met Juliet, he would have been all right. But because he was star-crossed, he did meet her. And because she came up with all sorts of plans that she didn't bother telling him about, he ended up taking poison and dying. Which is an important lesson for us to learn in life. I had Marilee to thank for this. You know, if she hadn't done what she did, I never would have figured out what Shakespeare was trying to express in Romeo and Juliet about what it means to be a human being. Do you think that's what Shakespeare was trying to express? Probably not. When I handed the essay in, Mrs. Baker read it through twice. So, she said slowly, do you think Juliet was right to stab herself at the end of the play? Yes, I said. I see, she said, and she put the essay in a manila folder and left it on top of her desk. But unlike Juliet, Marilee didn't stab herself. In fact, that afternoon she was waiting for me outside the gates of Camilla Junior High, standing beside a ridge of crusted snow that she had stamped down flat. It wasn't my fault, she said. Aren't you supposed to be at St. Adalbert's? I just showed him your drawing because it was so good. I didn't know he would use the same design. Sure, Marilee. It's true, she said. All right, it's true. Whatever you say, Marilee. You told him everything about my father's design, everything. And then a few days later, he draws up new plans so that the inside of his school is just like the inside of my father's school. You had nothing to do with it? I didn't say I had nothing to do with it, said Marilee. I said I didn't know he would use the same design. I'd keep the dark glasses on, Marilee. It's easier to lie to someone if they can't see your eyes. That's a nice thing to say. So we talk about Holland kind of learning how to be a level 5 and a level 6 kid. He is clearly not being either one right now. He's being very mean. Now, Marilee may have deserved it a little bit, but he's really hitting hard. He really doesn't know the story. She's trying to tell him her side of the story, and he's not really listening to it. A long moment went by. Then Marilee took off the glasses and threw them past my head. I think she was trying to throw them at my head. Then she turned and walked away, but not before I saw why she'd been wearing them. Why was she wearing the glasses? I picked up the glasses and put them in my pocket. That night, I saw those glasses flying past my head again and again and again, and I saw Marilee's red eyes again and again and again. So Marilee was crying because her dad did something bad and she didn't really have any control over it. Marilee wasn't in school the next day. I kept looking over at her empty desk. At lunch recess, I wrote a new Romeo and Juliet essay in the library. Here is the first sentence of the essay. What Romeo wanted to express about being a human being in Romeo and Juliet is that it's hard to care about two things at the same time. Like caring about the Montague family and caring about Juliet, too. So he is learning. Here is the last sentence. If Romeo had never met Juliet, maybe they both would have still been alive. But what would they have been alive for is the question that Shakespeare wants us to answer. So they were better to have known each other. I handed the essay to Mrs. Baker at the end of the day. She read it through twice. Then she took my old essay out of the manila folder, which was still up on top of her desk, and put in the new essay. She dropped the old essay into the trash, put the folder with the new essay into her desk, and then she looked up at me. So, what will you do now? She asked. So she knew. She knew what he was going through. Now she's telling him, you need to do more. That night, with 79 cents left over from Valentine's Day and $1 from Monday's allowance, I bought 2 Cokes and a rose with a ribbon. I took them over to Marilee's house and rang the doorbell. Mr. Kowalski answered it. You're the hood boy, he said. Is Marilee home? I said. He opened the door further and I came in. He hesitated. Then, "Her room is the one at the top of the stairs," he said. I went up the stairs slowly. I felt his eyes on my back, but I didn't want to turn around to let him know that I felt his eyes on my back. I knocked at Marilee's door. "Go away," she said. Who does she think is at the door? I knocked again. I heard her chair scrape against the floor and her footsteps stomping across the room. Her door opened. "I told you!" Then she stopped. Her mouth was open. So she's thinking that her dad was going to answer the door. And she's obviously not really getting along with him right now. So this is kind of our window into it wasn't her fault. Like, dad totally did this on his own. "I thought you might be thirsty," I said. Her mouth was still open. "Are you? Am I what? Thirsty?" She looked at the Cokes in my hand. "Yes," she said. I handed her a bottle and pulled the opener out of my pocket. I love the sound of a brand new bottle of Coke when you pry the lid off and it starts to fizz. Whenever I hear that sound, I think of roses, of sitting together with someone you care about, and of Romeo and Juliet waking up somewhere and saying to each other, "Weren't we jerks?" and then having all that be over. That's what I think of when I hear the sound of a brand new bottle of Coke being opened. You know, and in life, we have all of these sounds that connect to some of the important things. And this obviously is future hauling, remembering this moment and remembering, like, the mistakes that they both made, being jerks to each other. And that he went beyond himself, level 5, level 6, went over to her house and apologized without really having to apologize. He brought 2 Cokes, he brought the rose, and in sort of doing that, admitted that he'd been a jerk. On Thursday, before the school board met to decide on its new architect, Kowalski and Associates withdrew its bid for the new junior high school. Hood Hood and Associates was given the contract. "What chumps," said my father. "They were going to win hands down." "What chumps?" He shook his head. "They're bound to go under now, but if you can't play for keeps, you shouldn't be in the business in the first place. And Kowalski never could play for keeps, and Hood Hood and Associates can." He rubbed his hands together like Shylock on stage. So he just admitted it. He would be a bad person just to win. And that's when something changed. I suddenly wondered if my father was really like Shylock. Not because he loved ducats, but because maybe he had become the person that everyone expected him to become. I wondered if he had ever had a choice, or if he had ever felt trapped, or if he had ever imagined a different life. With this new contract, he was a sure bet for the Chamber of Commerce businessman of 1968. It's probably what everyone expected. For the first time, I wondered if it was what he wanted, or if there was a time when he might have wanted something else, or if I wanted something else, or if we were both only fortune's fools like Romeo. Well, this is interesting because he, again, this shows you how he's growing and not just thinking about himself. He's thinking, like, maybe my dad, like me, wants to do something else or wanted to at one point and couldn't. But this is the first time that he's admitted it out loud. So this could be a turning point. Marilee and I were partners on Friday for sentence diagramming. We ate together at lunch, and we decided to be partners for Mr. Petrelli's next geography assignment, which was on the California Gold Rush in U. "Make it relevant," said Mr. Petrelli. We sang together in chorus for Miss Violet of the Very Spiky Heels, and when it came time at the end of the day to clean the board, we did that together too. And that's why we were at the board together when Mr. Gureshi came into the classroom to give Mrs. Baker a yellow telegram. A telegram that she took out of the envelope, then read, then dropped onto the floor as she rushed out, leaving Mr. Gureshi standing in front of the class without any idea what to do. When we picked up the telegram to put on her desk, Marilee and I could hardly not read it ourselves, or at least the words that mattered. "Downed helicopter transport, stop. Kaysan, stop. Lieutenant T. Baker, missing in action, stop." We've already talked about MIAs last week. Missing in action means exactly that a soldier is missing in action. Sometimes they were dead. Sometimes they were in these camps where captured soldiers were kept for years and years. Sometimes they were just hurt and not accounted for. MIA is not a good place to be, especially when you're married to the person who's missing in action, not knowing where they're at. So obviously Mr. Baker is in some serious trouble or not even alive. The Battle of Khe Sanh is taking place, and we'll take a good look at the map of Khe Sanh right before we start tomorrow, just so you can kind of get an idea of what's going on in Vietnam at the end of February in 1968. The Battle of Khe Sanh actually started way back at the end of January. So this has been a battle that's gone on for a long period of time. Okay, so tomorrow we'll start with a little bit of a social studies lesson, and then we'll jump right into Wednesday Wars.
Now I'm waiting for Wednesday. You're back from out of town. The west is dry. Your mind is clear. Well, I don't want to be.